Good morning, and thank you, Jim. Thanks for the introduction. This is a big room. I was expecting kind of a small breakout. I'm excited to be here in the keynote. So let me tell you a bit about the open location journey, which is really the journey that we have been taking as a company as here in the last couple of years. And the slides work. If you haven't heard about here, the introduction was spot on. So actually, the company is already 35 years old. We have started mapping really early on. And chances are, if you are driving a car, there's probably map data somewhere in that car that is coming from us. 4 out of 5 cars use here data. And more recently, we are started the transition from a pure mapping company into a data processing platform company. Internally, we have been processing a lot of data, and working with geospatial data usually involves you working with quite a lot of data, especially if the ambitions are that you really want to cover the globe, and the globe is really big. And also, the context of the map is becoming much more vibrant. It's not enough to only have streets in there. The world is evolving, our ways of mobility, our ways of communication are evolving, and that means the map needs to evolve as well. So we are developers, we have been working in this field for a very long time, and we as developers like solving difficult problems, and we always think everybody has difficult problems. But more often than not, it turns out that the difficult part is almost academic. It's how you apply the application, how you use it in daily work, and I'm really thrilled and excited to hear about the Open Apparel activity, because that is really a trend that we're seeing in so many places right now, that industries who you wouldn't think about having a geospatial context actually suddenly find that geospatial connections are extremely relevant. So points on the map can be extremely powerful for some people, even if we as engineers kind of usually say, oh, it's just a point on the map. If the point on the map is something that is relevant for you, it becomes powerful. The point on the map can be a disaster. It can be an area where you don't want to go. It can be a place where your friends are. So it really depends on the context and what you want to do. And open source helps us to drive location relevance into different fields where we think with the heritage and experience that we have build up technically over the years, we can make a change. And also, open source allows us to hire the right developers. If you look at the t-shirts, open minds, open hearts, open source, that is really something that resonates. I couldn't have hired a better team when I was starting a new pod, a new activity in India, without pointing to this project being an open source project. We had amazing people coming in, not just technically amazing, but from a personal integrity standpoint, I'm super impressed by the team. They are going out there, they are working with teams, with people that have nothing to do with development, they don't have anything to do with the project necessarily. They want to give back, they want to make an impact, they want to change something. They are distributing food, and that is supported by our company as well. So we want to give back not only technically, we want to give back to the society and also figure out how can we make an impact on society and have something that is bigger than just building the next big technology, which we're doing as well. But back to the open location journey. So a journey usually starts somewhere, and for us, the open part started about 5 years ago or 4 years ago when Nokia sold the mapping business that they owned through the acquisition from Navtec and Navigation Technologies to a consortia of car manufacturers that you probably know, and that gave us an opening to think about how can we reposition the company and how can we build policies into the open source office that was established at that point to enable us to work better with the community. And Thomas, who is sitting here in front, he's running our open source office, and he has a couple of talks. There's another talk about something that I'm going to talk about in a second. But really, it has been kind of a roller coaster. We started to get active in the compliance space. So not really in the mapping space. That's where the activity started, because really, if you think about it, we have a big problem as an industry. If you want to use open source in a commercial environment, you need to be sure what you're shipping. And as developers, we're usually saying, oh, open source is easy, let's put that on GitHub, and that's it. No, that's not it. For us as a company, to put it on GitHub, we need to make sure what is in that software. And always, it is only the beginning of the journey. It's not the end. You need to build a community around it. You need to work with people. Good. Switching gears a bit. We have been working in a lot of those activities, but in the recent weeks and months, we have been joining a couple of foundations. For one, the Urban Computing Foundation, that is part of the Linux Foundation, where I'm very proud that I'm on the technical advisory committee as well. In addition to all the other activities that have been going on in the compliance space, if you want to know more about the Open Source Review Toolkit and the To-Do Group, OpenChain as well. And obviously, OSGeo is a big organization that we are sponsoring as well, that is primarily focused on geospatial activities. Quickly looking at the Urban Computing Foundations, what do we want to do? It was kicked off by Uber, and we found a couple of partners in Microsoft, Facebook, and also a smaller company like StreetCred and Transitland, where we're saying, what can we do together to make things easier, to share data, to work on data, to work on social problems that are happening in cities. Social problems or social challenges can be diverse, but essentially you can drive it all off data. And it goes into the pillars of sensing, getting the data in, analyzing data, managing data. Visualization is usually the first step, and then machine learning and city-scale simulation are the key drivers that we're currently looking towards for the Urban Computing Foundations. And for anybody who is interested, we're currently putting together the landscape, meaning the technologies that are relevant in these fields. If you want to contribute something to that, if you have something where you're saying that needs to be part of it, get in touch with us. We're on GitHub, we have a website, we have a Slack channel, so you can reach out to us. We're just starting this off. So visualization is usually the first step. You need to see what data you're dealing with. And there are some solutions out there. Some are proprietary, some are open source. And we thought there is a good way for us to establish an experimental project as well as open source, and it is already live out on GitHub, where we are saying, let's maybe take a slightly different approach than today's map rendering activities. Let me just quickly click through here. We said, let's build on open source technology and try something new. A lot of people have built map renderers, and if you want to contribute to that, you need to understand all that complexity that you have to deal with geospatial data, which means not only tiling, but projections, all the mathematics behind it, to really have a good-looking map display. And we thought, what could we do? For example, could we take an open-source gaming engine and turn it into a map display environment? And we did that using maps, using 3JS as a baseline, and it gives you vector map data as you would expect. The goal was really to build something that is 3D from the beginning, and the gaming engine is a good intro into this. And it obviously can work with raster data, that you can have satellite imagery as well as vector displayed together. It works natively with GeoJSON as well. You can animate stuff. Essentially, you can go down to the 3JS layer and do everything that 3JS enables you to do. And it is really intended as an experimental map display. What data can we put on a map? What people want to see on a map? And enable everybody to just use existing technologies and don't have to worry too much about the mapping aspect. And that means you can take the dancing stick figure from 3JS and just put it into a city scene. It's as simple as adjusting content in the scene that is already there, and you can manipulate the viewport. So it's a really nice solution. I probably wouldn't recommend today for you to use it in a production use case. It looks good, but it's certainly treated as an experimental technology. It's out on GitHub already. There's also a website. It's actually called harp.gl, where you can take the code, you can look at it, you can look at the samples. It's really something that you can get started with quite easily, but it already goes extremely deep. And yes, we're accepting pull requests, which might be different to other mapping solutions that you know out there. It goes as deep as lighting and shadows. And the nice thing about 3JS is that there's already a very established community out there. Maybe some of you are working with or in 3JS. There's an interesting project called Pottery, which allows us, by integrating Pottery into 3JS, to visualize LiDAR data, so image scans that are happening through laser, rotating lasers on top of vehicles or on top of other sensors, to just put that onto the same scene and see it in relation with your map. And it's really nothing where we would need to go out and build it. So we want to work with the open source community and see where can we as a company add value, but not replace anything that exists out there, but really integrate with that. But let's switch gears a bit, because visualization is only the first thing. And in my line of work, the thing that I'm constantly finding every single day for years is that people are telling me access to data is still too difficult. Managing data is difficult. And I'm hearing that outside when I'm talking to developers and other companies. And we also heard it inside in our company that depending at which point in time a certain data set was created, you had a different silo, a different application stack running. And a developer who needs to work with all of these data silos together and put it all, combine it onto a map, for example, would need to understand each underlying system. A couple of years back, we tackled that problem, and what we now want to do is open source the technology that we have built internally. It's already live. We haven't open sourced everything. Our commitment is to open source it by the end of the year, the complete stack. And what we really want to do is make coordinates, simple coordinates where points are located, as simple as words can be, but as powerful as words can be. So think about the solution we're calling XYZ as a content management system for location data. And I would like to connect with you. Maybe we can build something into our solution that makes your solution more powerful. Because really, normal people, not developers, don't care too much about the Linux kernel, the Postgres version, everything you need to do to install something. They just want to put everything together and start solving their specific problem. So it goes down in the direction of editing, manipulating data, sharing data, and having APIs so that you can run automatic processes on it. Machine learning is one of them. The stack exists of a couple of components. All of these components will be open source. And the key factors that are driving the development with the team inside here is It needs to be open, it needs to be interoperable with other technologies, and it needs to be real time. And just for the guys who come from the embedded conference, it's not the embedded real time timing. It's really embedded in a GIS world context where it's the geo world is kind of glacial. They are talking about hundreds of millions of years, where an hour is already fast. We are aiming at sub-second, 100 millisecond, 200 millisecond for a turnaround. We're starting with GeoJSON, managing GeoJSON through a single API interface. Points, lines, and areas on top of a map can already be very powerful. It can be easily extended to other data formats in future. And the basic building blocks for this need to be available. What we want to ensure, or what we want to propose, is a single API. We don't want to replace existing powerful APIs that are out there. We want to enable a single API that delegates to different content that you want to use. Behind the scenes, and if you know Linux and operating system development, it's not very surprising from an architectural point of view. Behind the scenes, there are powerful adapters, or in Linux, you would call them device drivers, that can talk to different backend systems to organize all that content into a consistent access pattern. It's really about sharing your data, having your styles in there, and telling your story. And we want to make that so easy that there's a UI layer on top of that where anybody without any technical experience can go in and just create and manage that content data. And the platform being used internally by HERE is not only for a couple of points on the map, it scales to terabytes of data, it scales to hundreds of millions of points. It can be, if you want that, contain a complete audit log of the changes so that you see how the data gets manipulated over time. And that is already available and hosting. And for the first time in HERE's history, and I'm really happy and proud about this, we are not only offering HERE data. We like our HERE data, but we recognize there's a very big data set with OSM out there that people are connected to and using. We're using both HERE and OSM datasets through the Linux Foundation's MapZen or NextZen project. So the company that you might know called MapZen was recently, beginning of last year, I think, transitioned into the Linux Foundation with its assets of TileZen and Tangram map display, and that goes towards the interoperability. In addition to that, we are providing resources and expertise from the visualization side, where our cartographers are really working on map styles and sharing map styles that you can use out of the box so that you don't have to worry about it, that are designed as a back cover for your data, where your data can live and nothing else gets in the way that isn't related to your story. You can completely configure that. The styles will be open source, the map display will be open source, and we're working actively on supporting these styles on as many different renderers as we can so that you can take even a Mapbox renderer or a Tangram renderer and just use the same styles. And for developers, it opens up a new paradigm of working with data where you don't have to worry about where do I store my data? How do I get my data back? How can I interact with data? Building visual experiences that are powerful from a UI perspective shouldn't be very difficult for developers if they don't have to worry about the infrastructure. But think about the power if you can change all of that data that you're seeing here right now by manipulating it live on the server side, and it shines through the UI immediately. So you have that live capability that we're expecting today from every web application when you're chatting and working in Office documents, that you see everything everybody else does. So it's really designed as a collaborative solution. And that brings me back to the Urban Computing Foundation. So really from the outset, the Urban Computing Foundation for me is something excitingly new that didn't exist, or that I'm not really aware for the Linux Foundation or for any other foundation out there. It focuses on two dimensions. On the one side, we're looking at technology. How can technology solve these problems? At the same time, we are looking outside to the society and trying to figure out what are the problems that require technology today to solve them. We need to work, we want to work with city planners, with governments, with everybody who has a stake in cities and urban development to really open up that field, because don't forget, right now already, over 60% of people are living in urban environments, and the UN predicts by 2050, two-thirds of the world's population will live in cities. I think open source can help building a solution that works for everyone. Thank you very much.